Okie dokie. The next presentation is my good self, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Maurice Gleason. I am a medical doctor, a psychiatrist, a pharmaceutical physician, a part-time actor, and primarily now a genetic genealogist. So I'm a jack of all trades and a master of none. But I will be talking to you today about using triangulation to break down brick walls in your Irish family tree. Now, what does that actually mean? Well, triangulation has actually been a technique used in geometry and in quantity surveying for a long time. And it's all about measuring a distant point by forming triangles to this point. So for example, here you have two folks with their theodolites or whatever those instruments are, and they're trying to point this distant tree. So in genealogy, what we're doing is the distant point is an ancestor. So we're here in the present, and the distant point is in the past, and the distant past, we're actually trying to triangulate on an ancestor. And what you have here is maybe two cousins who've done the DNA test, and what they're trying to do is to find out what DNA did they inherit from that distant ancestor that is shared by both of them. And that really is the concept of triangulation, and it's very similar to what's been used in trigonometry and geometry for many, many generations, many, many centuries. So previously on YouTube, and you can find this if you just Google YouTube, Maurice Gleason, step-by-step approach, it will bring you to some of my videos that I've done on how you can analyze your autosomal DNA data. And there are four steps that I normally do. Step one, where does the common ancestor sit? Step two, is the common ancestor obvious? Can you find it in each other's tree? Step three, we'll eliminate non-contenders. It can't be that ancestral line, it can't be that ancestral line, it can't be that. What am I left with? And step four, which is the step I'm going to talk about today, is triangulation, working with small groups of people of three or more. So that is the topic of today, working with small groups. And in order to do that, you have to identify groups who are likely to have the same common ancestor that has passed down DNA to everybody in that particular group. Now, for this, we will be using what family tree DNA call in common with matches, what Ancestry calls shared matches, and what 23andMe calls relatives in common. They're all the same thing. They're a small group of people that share DNA that is likely to have been passed down to them from the same ancestor back in the distant past. Now, there are several ways that you can approach this. I'm going to talk about two of those ways today. The first one is messy triangulation. And this is kind of the catch-all approach, but you'll see how it works and how it worked in my particular case. And that's working with known cousins, so you actually know the people involved, know the people that you're testing. They're triangulating on a known ancestral couple. So there's an ancestral couple in your tree, and you think, that's my brick wall, I really want to find out where they came from, and maybe push it back an extra generation. So you're triangulating on somebody that you already know from the paper record research that you've done, and you're trying to push your tree back in time. You're trying to get back an extra generation or two. Now there's other types of triangulation, for example, when we're working with adoptees, where you're triangulating back in time and then bringing the tree forward. You're trying to trace forward in time to the living descendants of the common ancestor to find the biological father or the biological mother of the adoptee. So there's various ways that we can use triangulation. Today, for genealogical purposes, we're going to push the tree back in time. Now, this is my family tree, and like all family trees, it's a little bit messy, and trying to get it all on one slide is difficult. But here's me here. There's my brothers and sister. There's my dad there. And dad goes back to these ancestors here. So his mother is Lily O'Carroll. Her mother was Elizabeth Spearman. Her father was Edward Joseph Spearman. And his father was Patrick Spearman, and his mother was Mary Morgan. So Patrick and Spearman and Mary Morgan were the triangulated ancestors. Those were the ancestors that the triangulation was aiming at. And I realized after a couple of years of getting involved in DNA that I had also tested dad's first cousin, who also went back to these ancestral couple. And Kathleen went back to the same couple, and Owen went back to the same couple. And you can see they're forming triangles. We're forming triangles back to this particular couple. And it occurred to me that any of the matches that any four of these cousins share in common with each other, well, they must have received DNA via this route, either from the Spearman side of the family or the Morgan side of the family. And this is what triangulating on a known ancestral couple is all about. Anyone who matches any two descendants has to be related, asterisk, via a common ancestor either at or above the level of Patrick Spearman and Mary Morgan, my three times great grandparents. Now, the asterisk is there because with everything in DNA, there's like, this is the rule, except in these circumstances. And then there's a long list of exceptions. And the exceptions here, if it's a false positive match, which is a match that suggests to you that you are related, when in fact, either you're not related at all, or the actual connection is much, much further back in time than the match would suggest. That happens from time to time, especially with the smaller segments of DNA. With larger segments of DNA, it's not so much of a problem, but anything below 10 centimorgans, the chances of it being a false match go higher and higher and higher, the smaller and smaller and smaller the DNA segment gets. It's an artifact of the system of analysis. And the second fly in the ointment is the second connection. How many people have cousins marrying cousins in their family tree? Well, that's just about everybody. You know, and that is the problem, is that when you come from a small, isolated, rural community, I think we have a few of them in Ireland, you tend to get people, cousins marrying cousins. You know, and it might be fifth cousins marrying each other or fourth cousins, but you know, it went up to first cousins as well. The father of modern genetics, well, not modern genetics, evolution, Charles Darwin, he married his first cousin who was from the Wedgwood family. So, and then three, they had more of their children died than the national average. So they were afflicted by perhaps this cousin intermarriage, but that's something that we'll be hearing about from Donna Rutherford in the next presentation. Now, so that's the second connection may very well be present. Let me just turn this off. And I'll just leave that there. So what I did was I compared each of these four cousins who are all descended from this common ancestral couple here, and I looked at the number of matches that they shared in common with each other. So it was, if you like to call them A, B, C, D, I compared A versus B, A versus C, A versus D, B versus C, B versus D, and then C versus D. And that gives you all the permutations of the possible combinations, because A versus B is the same as B versus A. So you get six possible combinations, and here they are here. So Dad and Cormac shared 53 matches out of their thousands of matches in common with each other. Dad and Kathleen shared 17 in common. Dad and Owen, 13 in common. Cormac and Kathleen, 34. Cormac and Owen, 15. Kathleen and Owen, 22. And I put them all into an Excel spreadsheet, and I sorted them, and I removed the duplicates, and I was left with 100 shared matches. And these were people that shared matches between any two of these four. At least two of these four cousins shared these matches. So then I just sent an email to every single match. Now, we didn't know whether the match was from the Spearman side of the family or from the Morgan side of the family. I was interested in the Spearman side because I run the Spearman Y-DNA project, and that's allowed me to break through a brick wall and take me back from my brick wall at 1800 in Tipperary to the 1600s in Limerick, to the 1500s in London, to the 1400s in Belgium, potentially. You know, it's opened up avenues of research that have pointed me back to the records, and it showed me where to look. And I've got some excellent data, and I'm still in the process of trying to tie it all together, but it's the DNA has directed my genealogical research. So I sent a personal 100 emails to every single one, and it was simply, you know, hi, you know, you match at least two of these, my four cousins, and we're all descended from Patrick Spearman and Mary Morgan. Do you have any Spearman or Morgan ancestors in your family tree? Yes or no? It was just that simple. And I got 49 responses, and they said, nope, 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 nope. The 50th response said yes. I said, oh, great, fantastic. Now we'll find out where the Spearans were before Limerick in the 1600s. Brilliant. Oh, it's a Morgan. Okay, well, I wasn't that interested in the Morgans, but okay, well, we just explore this. And his name is John Morgan, and here is a gravestone in Limerick, and here's a close-up, and it's erected by John Morgan in memory of his beloved wife, Mary, who died in 1879, aged 78 years. She was born about 1801. He was probably born around about the same time. And that is quite similar to when my Mary Morgan was born, around about 1800. So could they be brother and sister, first cousins, something like that? I said, could you show me your tree online? And they said, we haven't started it yet. All we know is what's written on the gravestone, where the rest of our family are buried. So guess who's doing the family tree? So I took it upon myself, and I was able to get a lot of information about this particular Morgan family branch, and I was able to take it back to John Morgan, who was a similar age to my great-great-great-grandmother, Mary Morgan. But I couldn't make the connection. I couldn't find any evidence or data that actually allowed me to connect John Morgan and Mary Morgan together. So after months of research, we put the research aside and said, hopefully something will come along in due course. So then, as is the case with genealogy, you wait. And 2 years later, we got the 51st response. Now the 51st response was a new DNA match. And it was another Morgan ancestor. He actually had an ancestor called Patrick Morgan, who was in the Royal Irish Constabulary. And here you see him in a photograph probably taken in the 1860s. This is his uniform. He was governor of Maryborough Jail. And this sword, ceremonial sword, is still on the wall of the Morgan household in Dublin. So, a beautiful photograph, and this is the first time I've actually seen an actual Morgan photograph. He was born around about the same time, 1812. He could have been a younger brother of my Mary and the other person's John, but it caused me to... There were rumours also of a link to Wales. And of course, Morgan is a very Welsh name, but it could also be a native Gaelic Irish as well. So we didn't. I never could decide one way or the other what it could possibly be. So I took out all the old research. I found a tree online because I started Googling again and said, is there anything new on the internet? Let me see what I can find. And I found this tree. And look, there is Patrick Morgan, 1812. And it has his parents in it. And I thought, oh, this is really lucky. We've actually found the parents for my match. He's going to be really, really pleased about that. And then I looked along the list, there's Elizabeth Morgan, and she marries a John Gorman. She obviously was very fond of anagrams. And then there's that's a John Morgan there. That could be the John Morgan that I found 2 years ago. Hold on. Those are my great-great-grandparents. What are my great-great-grandparents doing in this tree? And I looked for sources, there's no sources. And the author had put this up 3 years previously, so I thought, there's no sources in this tree. 3 years ago, I'm going to contact him. I'm not going to get any reply at all. But I did, 4 days later. I asked him, why do you have my great-great-grandparents in your tree, please? And he wrote back saying, because I have Professor Wardell's notebooks from 1906. Who is Professor Wardell? Well, he was Professor of Military History in Trinity College, Dublin, in the early 1900s, and Professor Wardell, the Abbey of Shenagold in County Limerick, later Trinity College, Dublin, is collecting materials for a history of the Morgan name in Ireland. I thought, oh my goodness, have I hit the jackpot here? Is this somebody who's actually spent his retirement researching the Morgan surname? And then I found something else. Notes and Queries, 1849. Irish claim to Welsh baronetcy. The complete baronetage shows that a claim was prepared by the Morgans of Monasterevin, put forward by the industrious genealogist. This is a genealogist now from 1849 who's done all this work, two 18th century letters, which may or may not be genuine. So it started, suddenly this mystery starts unraveling. And Professor Wardell's notebooks fell into the hands of this 51st match. the chap who owned the family tree. And this is an extract from his books. And it's difficult to see, but there is my Mary Morgan, married to a Patrick Spearon. These are all the brothers and sisters of Mary Morgan, including Patrick Morgan from 1812, and also there's a John Morgan up there as well, somewhere along the way. There we go, John. And from this I learned that Patrick Spearon came from Cappa, Ballingarry, County Limerick. I never knew where my Patrick Spearon was born. So already I'm getting information about his place of birth. Not only that, but he marries Mary Morgan, who became R.C. So she changed her religion from Church of Ireland to Roman Catholic. And that's a very, very common thing that we see in our own family trees. How many people have seen a change in religion in their family trees? Quite a few people. So this was the gold mine. But not only that, not only did it push me back an extra generation, it pushed me back, and where am I? So those are going to be my fourth times great-grandparents, fifth time, sixth time, seventh time great-grandparents. So I've gone back four generations more, and not only that, but they go back to the Morgans of Tredegar, apparently, and they go back, well, here's a, they have this kind of crest and coat of arms, 1031. So am I now going back to 1031? This is ridiculous. You know, I fell off my chair so many times when I was reading this, I couldn't believe it was actually happening. And I even found, I have to show you my new house. And it's, you're a wonderful audience. You're all invited to come over for a weekend. The lads can play polo, and the girls can relax on the lawn playing croquet. And then we all dance the night away in my ballroom, and we'll have breakfast served to us by our live-in waiter, Manuel, who's from Barcelona. So this is Tredegar House. This is where the Morgans used to live. And suddenly, I'm seeing them in the Dictionary of Welsh Biography. I'm seeing them on websites around the world. And there's this wealth of information about the Morgans. They're on Wikipedia. There are scandals and tales of Tredegar House. I'm even related to this chap. He is Captain Morgan. He's my own Jack Sparrow, Pirate of the Caribbean, in my own family tree. And he later became Sir Henry Morgan, so he went from pirate to governor of Jamaica, where he had lots of plantations. So now I have a relative who was a slaveholder. So now I have to incorporate slavery into my family tree. It raises very interesting questions. I'm also related to this chap from a pedigree I found in Salt Lake City, which goes back to, we don't know his surname yet, but apparently he's my 472nd great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandfather. And pedigree of the Morgan family from Noah down to Sir William Morgan, Knight, 1612, made out about 1825. So now I'm related to this chap here, Sir William Morgan, who did his pedigree back to Noah. Obviously, there's a lot of myth and fantasy here, but I have to double-check every single figure, every single fact, to make sure that this is all kosher. I'm also related to this chap here. Anybody know who he is? Exactly. J.P. Morgan, wealthy American industrialist, Morgan Chase Banks. I should be rich, but I'm not. I'm also related to this person here. Because she goes back to the same Sir William Morgan, who was born in 1571 and did the pedigree in 1612. So is anybody else related to Princess Diana? Okay, Debbie, okay. Debbie, I'll see you at the wedding in May. So suddenly, triangulation has opened up a whole wealth of material that remains to be explored, verified, discarded, taken on board. A lot of fact-checking, but this is opening up an area of research that I would never have dreamt of had I not actually done DNA and done this triangulation exercise with four cousins who happened to have the same three times great-grandparents. So that's that. The last thing, of course, let's look at this false positive second connection present problem, and I'm just going to check the time, not too bad. To identify shared matches, what we do on family tree DNA is look at the in common with feature. So you go into your family tree DNA results, there is a tab that just says in common with. you click on the cousin that you want to triangulate with. So for me, it would be I go into my dad's results, his cousin Cormac comes up as a very, very close match. I just put a tick in the Cormac's box and then press in common with, and it generates all of the matches that dad and Cormac share in common with each other. These are their shared matches. These are their relatives in common, all the same thing. And Family Tree DNA allows you to download the spreadsheet. Download it into an Excel spreadsheet, remove the duplicates, and then send an individual email, not a bulk email, but an individual personalized email to every single person on that list. I got a 50% response rate, which is not bad. And the 51st response was the corker. That's the one that broke through the brick wall in ways that I could never have imagined. The second connection, how to ruin a good party. It's the spanner in the works, it's the fly in the ointment, because many of us will have a second connection. So for example, here is Dad, and here's his cousin Alan. And that's how they're connected up there. Their common ancestors are John and Anne Gleason. And their common ancestors somewhere up there, supposing they have a match with Mary, who's a shared match. They both share Mary as one of their matches. It could be that the common ancestor has maybe three DNA segments that it's passing down to them, a red one, a black one, a blue one. It might have passed down a black one and a red one to Alan. It might have passed down a black one and a blue one to Dad. It might have passed down a blue one and a red one to Mary. So none of them have actually inherited all three DNA segments, just the luck of the genetic lottery, you get what you're given. But they've all got, you know, two out of those three. And because of that, they all match each other, and it looks like they're all related via the same common ancestor. And a lot of the time, they will be. But here's an alternative explanation. Let me come to the next one. Supposing common ancestor number one between Dad and Alan just passes down a black segment. So Alan gets a black segment from this ancestor, Dad gets a black segment from that ancestor, the same one, the same ancestor. Supposing there's a second connection, and they both, you know, they have a second ancestor who passes down a red segment to Alan and a red segment to Mary. So Alan and Mary have a separate common ancestor. And then supposing there's a third common ancestor shared between Dad and Mary who passes down the blue segment. When you look at your matches, it's going to be exactly the same result. A matches B, B matches C, C matches A. But they don't have the same common ancestor. They've got three separate common ancestors. So that can happen. And especially when you get these double connections, and especially when you come from a small, isolated rural community, and there are cousins marrying cousins. So you have to be careful about this. And of course, the further back in time that you go, the more likely this second connection can be a fly in the ointment. You know, with third cousins, I think you're relatively okay. If you start getting back to the fourth cousin level, the fifth cousin level, I think the chances of finding a second connection within your family tree get higher and higher and higher. And eventually, you're going to get what's called pedigree collapse. Because if you take, my dad loves this calculation, if you take this, two parents, four grandparents, eight great-grandparents, 16, 32, 64, take it back to 2,000 years, you have trillions of people in your family tree, more people than ever lived on the planet. So there is going to be cousins marrying cousins as you go back in time. He calls it socially acceptable inbreeding. So all three match each other. They come back as shared matches using the in common with facility on Family Tree DNA, but none share a single common ancestor, and the chance of a second connection is more likely the further you go back in your tree. So if all shared matches match each other, this could mean either all three share one overall common ancestor. That was example number one. Number two, each pair has a common ancestor, and there is no overall common ancestor shared by all three people. Or alternatively, all three of them do share one single common ancestor, and there is also a second connection with two of them, or even with all three of them. So those are the kind of options you need to keep in mind, and that's why I describe it as a fly in the ointment, because it can be misleading. And what's the probability of each scenario? I have no idea. How do we distinguish between each scenario? That's when we come on to the second type of triangulation. And I just call it purist triangulation to distinguish it from messy triangulation. And the purist triangulation means proving a particular DNA segment is shared by all three people. Now, this is where we get really technical. I don't like it. I think the messy triangulation is good enough because ultimately, you're still going to have to go back to the records to prove that the connection actually is true. But here is what we actually use to do this purist triangulation. We want to look for overlapping segments. We want to create what is called a triangulated group, which is a very specific definition in genetic genealogy. You can also use phased data, and ideally that's what you would need to do to be absolutely certain you have found a triangulated group, and this is the purest approach. And there are a lot of blogs written about it, so Blaine Bettinger, who writes the Genetic Genealogist blog, has talked about a triangulation intervention. And there is a Wikipedia definition of triangulation as well, but that's mainly talking about Y-DNA and mitochondrial DNA, whereas with this one we're talking about autosomal DNA, which is all the rest of your chromosomes. There's also some blogs on triangulation written by Jim Bartlett, Segmentology. He talks about how to triangulate, does the triangulation work? So you can get a lot of information from these blogs on how to actually go through the whole process if you are interested in doing that. Some of you may be, it's very time intensive, and if you have spare time on your hands, well and good. I prefer the messy triangulation method because I think it's much more all-encompassing. But with this type of triangulation where you're looking for a DNA segment that is shared by everybody in the group, and here are a few more blogs that deal with it, you end up with something like this. So here is a similar example. These are the cousins that were tested, and they all go back to this particular ancestral couple here. So they're all triangulating on this particular ancestral couple. But look at the DNA segments that are shared between all of them. Here is a DNA segment shared just between these two people. All of these single lines are DNA segments shared between two people. This one is overlapping. That one is shared between these two people here and also these two people here. So there's three people involved in that particular segment. So that's an overlapping segment that is shared by more than two people. Excuse me. What else do we have? Here's another overlapping segment. So that's going to be shared by more than two people. Here's an overlapping segment here that's shared by more than two people. And here is one that is shared by the blue, the purple, the red, the orange, the green. That is the largest one, but it doesn't include absolutely everybody in the group. So if we were just going to use this as the triangulated segment that must have come from the common ancestor, you'd only be looking at the matches for these people, and you wouldn't be looking at the matches for the other people in this particular triangulation group. And that, to me, is perhaps an example of throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Because I think there's a lot of useful information that to be had by looking at all of the shared matches between a group of people, because that is how I managed to get my Morgan problem solved. And you do have to be aware that you could be going down a false track, because there might be double connections, there might be false matches there as well. But this purist approach doesn't get you, it is very pure, and you can say for sure that these people have a 99.99999% chance of actually inheriting that particular DNA segment from the ancestral couple upon which everyone is triangulating. However, and the reason why this happens is because we have two copies. Ideally, you'd want to just compare chromosome 21 with chromosome 21. You know, your copy of chromosome 21, say from your paternal side, with the one copy of chromosome 21 from your match. But of course, we get two copies of each chromosome from our parents. One from our mother, one from our father. So when the machine is reading these chromosomes, it reports the value of the bases on each of the chromosomes in turn, So at this particular position, I have a value of TT, I have a value of GG at this position, at this position here it's AG, at this position here it's CC. So that's my chromosome 21, and those are the particular points that I have on that particular chromosome. When I'm comparing mine with my match, this is my match's two chromosomes, so I'm comparing my two with my match's two. My match is going to have maybe a TT in this position, a CT in this position, a GA, and a CA. And when you compare, you're comparing two bases on your match's chromosome with the two bases on your chromosome. And we can illustrate this graphically by looking at a fully identical region, a non-identical region, or a half-identical region. So a full-identical region, TT matches TT. The two letters from me match the two letters from my match. GG does not match CT in any way whatsoever. AG is a full match, because it doesn't matter whether it's AG or GA. So AG and GA are a full, fully identical region. And CC and CA only share one C in common with each other. And that's called a half-identical region. So that's the kind of printout you'll get on GEDmatch if you upload your data to GEDmatch. And it's a very useful visual way of actually representing the match between two people. But if we phase the data, and that means instead of comparing two chromosomes with two chromosomes, we isolate the maternal chromosome from the paternal chromosome, and we just compare one of our chromosomes with one of our match's chromosomes. And if we did that, this would change the values to T, G, G, and C. And if we did the same on our match's side and just looked at one chromosome, we'd have T, C, A, and C. And this would change this visual diagram to this one. We have a fully identical region, a non-identical region, a non-identical region, and this would go to a fully identical region. So that's what the phasing does. By separating out your maternal from your paternal copies of your chromosome and getting your match to do the same, you actually can get a much clearer picture of where you actually match each other on a DNA segment. And this could be used for triangulation because it would actually help to identify triangulated groups much more efficiently. It's not essential, but it would certainly help. So a triangulated group is defined as three or more people share the exact same DNA segment, all are shared matches to each other, the same as the in common with status, all have the same DNA segment, either in its entirety or in just overlapping parts. And you can add in phased data to this definition as well. It confirms that the same segment originates from the same common ancestor. That is the purest approach. You can see it's quite technical. You can see that it is quite complicated, and it's not something that I would recommend to people because I think the messy approach is good enough for the beginner. And just to show you, my dad's matches with those four cousins that were Morgans. There's my dad there. The only overlapping segment is this one down here, which he shares with only two of those four people. So if I was just looking, taking the purest approach with my dad, I'd only be looking at the matches for two of his cousins rather than all four of his cousins. So triangulation means different things to different people. It can be effective without getting into technicalities. It can be confirmed by searching for overlapping segments. Overlapping segments are not always present, so proof is not always possible, but it does not negate the findings nevertheless. Just because you can't find an overlapping segment doesn't mean that you're not related to this particular, via this particular triangulated ancestral couple. Documentary evidence of a connection is good, but it does not confirm that the DNA was transmitted to all shared matches. So that overlapping segment that my dad has with those two cousins, I'm assuming they came from either Patrick Spearin or Mary Morgan, but they could have come from a second connection that I haven't uncovered yet. So you have to keep that in mind as well. And using phased data maximizes the veracity of true overlapping segments. Using overlapping segments and phased data only identifies a small proportion of all possible triangulated groups. and messy triangulation still has an important role to play. So after all that, DNA is a pointer. And I'm going to bring it back to the very, very beginning. DNA is a pointer that just says you and you, you're related to him. Now go away and find out how you're connected. And to find out how you're connected, you go back to the records. But what DNA has done is it has shown you where to look. And that, you know, if that's all you take from this lecture, that is the most important message. DNA is just a pointer. It shows you where to look. It helps you focus your genealogical research. But you will have to go back to the records to confirm that you are related via a named ancestor. So that's what makes DNA such a useful tool, is because even though you can get wonderfully technical about it, you don't have to. You can simply use it as a device. You know, when people write to me and say, oh, but DNA says we're related, it's on chromosome 18, it's a 10 centimorgan segment, I go, stop, let me just stop you there. Here's my family tree. Do you recognize any names, any locations, or any places? And if the answer is no, then we're still back where we started. We're still at that brick wall. And it's thanks very much for getting in touch. Wishing you the very best of luck with your genealogical research. And if you find out anything more, be sure to get back in touch with me. And then it goes into my black hole folder called Autosomal DNA Matches. So that's really all I have to say. And I will say thank you very much. And if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Brad is going to be kind enough to bring the microphone around if anybody has any questions. Any questions from everyone? Anyone? Absolutely, and that's why I think the Morgan example is such a wonderful example, because all I did was to see who are the people that match any two of these four cousins. And let's assume that that DNA has to come down either via Patrick Spirin or Mary Morgan, and let's just do a blunderbuss effect. Let's contact everybody on that who are a shared match. I didn't bother looking at the DNA. In fact, the chart that I showed about my dad and his matches to these fourth cousins, I only thought about it afterwards because it didn't even cross my mind to go and check the DNA. All I know about the DNA is it's saying, you're a match. You still have to go back to the records. And I thought, oh, I actually better look on the chromosome browser and just see what the DNA segments are that are shared and see if there's any overlapping segments. But it was very much a secondary thought. Now, I know that's going to be heresy, probably, to a lot of people who spend a lot of time pinpointing which DNA segment came from which ancestor. But I think if the fact that I had to wait for the 51st response to actually solve the question shows that if you are going to throw out a lot of potential shared matches, throw them away because they don't have a triangulated segment, you are going to be losing the opportunity of getting in touch with the one person who has Professor Wardell's notebooks, who has that genealogy that goes back to the 1000s, who has that family Bible that has all of your ancestors an extra two generations on the line that you're interested in, who has the letters in the attic that nobody really cares about, but they were frightened to throw them out. So for me, the messy triangulation approach and just looking at your shared matches is still a very, very good way to actually approach the whole thing. And I think it saves you a lot of time, because all you have to do is send 100 emails, and that saves you having to understand the technicalities of a triangulated segment and other finer niceties of the technicalities.
Yeah, Wonderful. Any other questions?
There's one from John Reed here. There's one from Patty Walton over here.
Okay.
I'm going to be the skeptic here.
Fine.
If instead of being fascinated with Osirian ancestry, you had been fascinated with your Morgan ancestry,
mm-hmm.
don't you think you would have got to the same conclusion without any DNA evidence?
Very good question. And the answer is quite possibly yes. But I was particularly focused on a particular ancestral line. And I think that's true for a lot of us, is that when we are going to do our tree, there are certain ancestors that interest us more than others. There are certain surnames that interest us more than others. I don't know why I didn't find that Morgan family tree 2 years previously when I first did the research, because I was on Google and I was looking at various things, and it probably was still up there at that point in time. So I didn't see it back then, and that's another feature of genealogy, is that you Google something, you find it, and then 2 years later you find it again, and you've forgotten that you found it 2 years before. You think it's fantastically new, and you're really excited, and the more you look at it, you think, this sounds familiar, I'm having the strangest deja vu. It is deja vu, because you've deja vu'd it already. So, I could have possibly found it through conventional means, but I would argue that the DNA can help speed up your discovery of the right records. Heather.
Marcus, I have a lovely example for your blue segment, your green segment, your blue, your red, and your black segment.
Can I just say that Paddy, usually when I find something, Paddy says, oh, I just heard from your fifth cousin. So, easy.
We'll come to that at the end of this. My great-great-grandparent, I forget how many great grandparents. Thomas Parker married Mary Keyes in 1831. In 1840, Thomas's brother Francis Parker married Margaret Smith. In 1841, Margaret's brother Joseph Smith married Mary Keyes' sister Ellen Keyes. So each of them had a family. We have three families. Each family are first cousins to the other two. They have no single common ancestor that I am aware of. So if you take their DNA, they will. One person from each family, you would have three people who all look like first cousins to each other. If you look at their half-identical regions, their first cousins, I'm pretty sure there will be regions in which all three are half-identical to each other. But even in that case, we have the exception to the rule. It does not necessarily follow that there is a common ancestor until you go and do the phasing.
Yeah.
The phasing is going to be the only way to rule out cases like that.
Absolutely.
And my Thomas Parker had a first cousin also called Thomas Parker, who married Susanna Latchford, whose mother was Alice Morgan, who was one of your Morgans.
There you go. I knew it was coming. Thank you, Pat.
That's wonderful. Let's all put our hands together now for Dr. Morris Mason. His wonderful presentation. We're very eliminating using DNA to find a waterfall of genealogical information from a brick wall. So congratulations.
Thanks very much, Brad. And the next presentation here is going to be the final presentation of Genetic Genealogy Ireland 2018 Belfast, and it'll be from Donna Rutherford, who will be taking us on the Game of Genes. Oh no, is that Gilbert actually? I'm so much looking forward to Donna's presentation that Ed is standing there at the back of the room. I apologize profusely, Ed. How can you possibly forgive me? So it'll be Ed Gilbert here in about 5 minutes time. No, I just wanted to give you a heart attack.
Hi, how are you?
Stefan, do you match?
I get
most people in Ireland who I've tested.
Do I match most people?
A relatively small number of people in Ireland have tested.
Oh no, quite a few
really?
Have tested. Yeah. No, it's over 100,000, I'd say.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. No, between the various companies, it's quite a few people. So
you come up in my matches, you know, from Southwick.
Really?
Yeah.
You're going to have to send me an email and tell me. And
well, I've looked at your surnames, and none of them. Well, I mean, Burns and Wicklow have Burns in my tree, but.